Good morning. I'm Michelle Pettit. I am one of the Conference Executive Committee members, and it is my privilege to be able to make the introductions for our first plenary session, Leadership in the Law. Now, several people have asked me, like, why are we talking about leadership? What is this program about? So I want to open us today to give you a little background so you understand kind of the method of our madness. I come from a military background, and as a military officer, from day one, you are trained constantly throughout your career on how to be an ethical, effective, and an authentic leader. And when I made the transition from active duty into the civilian practice of law, I realized that there just wasn't much leadership training, if at all, that was ever given to any of the attorneys, despite the leadership positions that they were holding. And in recent years, when I've observed problems in the workplace or conflicts in the courtroom or just issues that arise in the legal community, I found myself analyzing it as a leadership failure. And I thought to myself, you know, we should be doing better as lawyers, as the leaders in our community. And why are we not giving the tools to the lawyers that they need? Last year, I read an article by Deborah Rohde, from a professor from Stanford Law School. And this particular article called Leadership in the Law can be found in your materials on the website, and I would commend everyone to read it. It's one of the most comprehensive articles I've read on leadership specific to the legal community. And some of her messages in that article really struck a chord with me. I wanted to share with you a quote that she, in one of her keynote speeches that she made at Santa Clara School of Law. And this quote really, I think, strikes home. She said, it is ironic that the occupation most responsible for producing America's prominent leaders has done so little to educate them for that role. The legal profession, although only 0.4% of the population, has supplied a majority of American presidents, and in recent decades, almost half of Congress. Lawyers occupy leadership roles as governors, state legislatures, judges, prosecutors, general counsel, law firm managing partners, and heads of corporate, government, and nonprofit organizations. Almost none of these lawyers received academic training for their leadership responsibilities. Although leadership development is now a $45 billion industry, it is missing or marginal in legal education. Now, in taking that one step further, no matter what job you have in the legal profession, just by being a lawyer, you are in some way, in some capacity, being a leader. And your community is looking up to you to lead, whether you're trained to do so or not. So it's really important that we recognize that the titles we are given are just that, titles. On the other hand, being an effective leader is a deliberate act. And I want that really to sink in. A title is just a title, but being an effective leader is a deliberate act. When you take on a leadership role, you should be considering what type of leader you want to be, what type of style and strategies you want to use. And sometimes I've seen leaders, they assume a leadership role, and as they do so, they assume the people that are their subordinates or their followers. But it's important to recognize they're just subordinates. You have to develop followers, and that's based on your leadership. One of my favorite quotes from Deborah Rohde's article is that leadership is not a solo act, it is a team effort. And part of the things we're going to discuss today, the paradox of leadership, is that once leaders are given that position, that power of influence, they have a natural tendency to feel empowered to do whatever they want, to feel justified in their actions. And what makes that even worse is that as a leader, their subordinates often don't feel comfortable giving them critical feedback or telling them what's really going wrong. And it's very important as leaders, we stop and have self-reflection and ask for that critical feedback and look for it to develop ourselves as leaders. So as to the question of why are we talking about leadership today, our courts are the forefront of addressing some of our nation's greatest issues, such as human rights violations, social injustice. In the criminal context, we're in charge of someone's life and liberty. The leadership we display in our courtrooms and our legal communities have a direct correlation to the public's confidence in our government and our judicial system. That's why it's really important that we spend time discussing these issues, discussing what it means to be a really good leader. And it is our sincere hope that while we're discussing this today and you're listening to our panelists, that you will have self-reflection and we can all think about how can we be better leaders? How can we be more engaged? How can we set the standard of respect, civility, and inclusivity? Now, I think it's really important to note that we have three very distinguished panelists today. But I want you all to know they are not here based on their titles. They were specifically requested to be here because of who they are and how they lead. And we are very honored today to be able to have them here to share their experiences and wisdom that hopefully will help us to be better leaders. Now, in selecting the moderator today, I have the ability to introduce her today. We were looking for someone who's experienced, outspoken, passionate, and a risk taker. So, of course, we selected Circuit Judge Callahan. So, into introducing her, I didn't want you to reread her bio that you can find on the website materials, but I wanted to tell you a little bit about her, things you might not know. For example, she's a skydiver. She's a professional tap dancer. And she is clearly the best dressed in the room at all times. But most importantly, she really is a valued member of the circuit. She is a true leader in the Ninth Circuit. With that, I pass this to Judge Callahan.
Well, good morning. I have the pleasure of introducing our speakers. And one thing that I want to let you know, you do have papers on your table. And so at the end of the program, we're going to try to leave 10 to 15 minutes for questions. So if you write your questions down, they'll be collected and then they'll be looked at, and if they're not too ridiculous, we will answer them. So someone will screen them and then I'll look at them, and then if I ask the question, they might say to me, "Now really, Connie, you expect me to answer that?" But anyway, I like to introduce people. You have all of their bios. And so you've read all of that, but I'd like to tell you a little bit of some other things that you might not know about the individuals, and also give you some concept about their leadership. Now, I have my chief judge, Sydney Thomas, and all of our three panelists, I think you might find interesting, are the first lawyers in their families. So they don't come, and I think as you will see too, we're not an Eastern-centric Ivy League panel. And I think that I noticed these things. Now, our chief hails from Montana, and he was, in terms of leadership, he was the student body president of his high school. And then in college, he was a student member to the Regents, the student member on the Board of Regents. He went to Montana State undergraduate for his BA, University of Montana for his JD. His parents met in graduate school, and they both were educators, and eventually both had PhDs. His dad was a professor and a scientist in Montana, and his mother also was a high school principal and then taught at the college level. Now, his job in college was to be a computer programmer. He played basketball, and I'm told that his siblings, his sister's the choral director, his other sister's a minister, so all three of the children wear black robes. So he brings that distinction. But our chief judge, the Ninth Circuit administratively consists of 63 separate units, including the circuit court, the district courts, the bankruptcy courts, and pretrial and probation units. The circuit has approximately 5,500 employees. There are 450 total judges in the Ninth Circuit. The Court of Appeals has 29 authorized judgeships, and as of now, including senior judges, it has 44 judges on the circuit court. The Ninth Circuit covers a geographic area larger than the old Roman Empire. And within its boundaries, it has one-fifth of the nation's population. The circuit court handles approximately one-third of the nation's federal appeals. Next to our chief judge is Chief Justice Tani Cantil Sakaui, the Chief Justice of California. She is a California girl, like I am, and we quote the Beach Boys, wish they could all be California girls, but they're not. But her parents came from very humble backgrounds, were farm workers turned government workers. She began at community college, then went to UC Davis, transferred UC Davis Law School. Her sports were tennis, and her jobs in college and law school, where you can't really beat this, she was a waitress and a blackjack dealer. So we'll see how that comes into her leadership. She was a cheerleader at McClatchy High, which is the alma mater of Justice Kennedy as well. So fight on, and she as well was in student government and debate. I'm also, so we have student leaders. I think the chief went the furthest back. He apparently was a president in second grade, but they worked their way up. Our Chief Justice of California sits on the state Supreme Court and chairs the Judicial Council, the governing body of the state judicial branch. The California judicial system consists of 58 superior courts located in 58 counties, 6 appellate courts, the 7-member Supreme Court, approximately 1,900 judges and justices, and 20,100 employees in the trial courts, appellate courts, and the Judicial Council. Next is our Director, Jim Duff, of the Administrative Office of the Courts. Director Duff was born in Ohio. His parents moved from Kentucky, where they still have the family farm. His mother was the first Head Start teacher in Hamilton, Ohio. His dad was a spectroscopist. I practiced that, but it didn't work. He walked on as a basketball player at the University of Kentucky. He went to law school at Georgetown Law, but interestingly, he went to night school while he was working full-time for Chief Justice Berger in his chambers as an administrative assistant during the day. He was a sixth grade student body president, and the pride of his parents when, as a senior, he was named the class clown. Director Duff is the director of the Administrative Office of the U.S. Courts, oversees the management of and the budget of the federal judiciary, which consists of 30,000 employees, including over 2,300 federal judges in 414 federal courthouses. The budget of the judicial branch will be approximately $7.5 billion next year. He also serves as the Secretary of the Judicial Conference of the United States, which in addition to the 26 federal judges who sit on the conference consists of 25 conference committees composed of more than 250 federal judges appointed by the Chief Justice. Additionally, the director appoints over 100 federal judges to advisory committees to assist him in policy formation for the branch. And he oversees the operation of the Administrative Office of the Courts, which itself has 1,100 employees. So you know a little bit about where they came from, you know a little bit about who they, where their leadership is being acted out as we speak. So let's get down to the issues. I want to start with, I think I'll start with our chief judge. Many people view leadership as a title or a position, which experts view leadership as an activity or a relationship that involves influence. In your experience, Chief, how has your leadership and influence been an activity rather than a title?
Well, I would say when I took over as chief judge, they gave me this big manual that said the powers of chief judge, and I really eagerly started flipping through it. And then I said, you know, if I have to use any of these things, I've really failed as a chief. And I think that's very true, particularly when we're dealing with the judiciary, which is not a hierarchical enterprise like a corporation or even an executive agency. We're dealing with Article 3 judges, Article 1 judges, and people who've been appointed by others. And if you don't engage people into a vision and a cooperative endeavor, you're not going to succeed. And no amount of the powers that were in that book can teach you that. So it's been wonderful on our court. We have great judges, and I compliment Judge Callahan, who has been so great to work with and such a force for the judiciary. But without people like Judge Callahan, the people on our court, we couldn't succeed.
Chief Justice?
Thank you. And I also want to thank the conference for inviting me to be here. It's a pleasure. I would say that my role is as a leader, as an activity, is really one that I found, sort of I stumbled upon in my first year as Chief Justice in 2011. And that was the convening role. My activity, of course, is the same as my colleagues on the Supreme Court. I am just one of seven. So I carry the same caseload, but I also have the administrative responsibilities of the California judiciary. And I found that early on, some of our problems and challenges, particularly in the Great Recession, really needed amplification, it needed collaboration, it needed understanding, it needed advocacy. And so I took my role as Chief Justice as an activity, and I convened people. I convened people who never sat down at a table together. I convened plaintiff's lawyers, defense lawyers, corporate counsel at all parts and regions of California to explain the judiciary, explain our budget, explain our processes, and explain our challenges. And I did it in a way to evoke, well, how can we help you? And it became a coalition of Open Courts, coalition of diverse judges and lawyers and court staff to advocate for the branch. And then when I saw that people didn't understand the judiciary, I convened school superintendents, constitutional officers, social workers, union organizers, business presidents, and I said, let's sit down at a table and talk to me about the power of democracy and the judiciary's role in it. Convene people to talk about what we had in common. And again, a group formed from this challenge of what we all face was a misunderstanding of our collective roles in government. So I feel that my activity has been to convene thinkers, naysayers, people who don't really even know what's going on, but to bring them up, to educate them about becoming more involved in the branch. So my activity has been travel, convening, educating, in addition to the more traditional roles that you and I all share as judges.
Well, it seems like Deborah Rhodes' article talks about leadership as not being a solo act. It's a team effort. It sounds like you've really taken that to the heart. And that how much of the team effort would you say has been a part of your success as a leader and how you fostered that team effort?
Well, just as the Chief Judge has said, when you are at the top of the food chain of judges and lawyers, it's a dangerous place. There's a lot of snapping going on below your feet. And so you can't lead, as Michelle said, it's more than a title. You have to bring people on and share a purpose, and to respect each other in the shared purpose, and to respect the contradictions, and to get a better product. So it's different, as the Chief Judge indicated. It's not a corporation, we're not paramilitary. We have to encourage people to join us. They have to agree and volunteer and want to be part of the team, because you can't order judges to be part of anything.
Well, Director Duff, you have judges and you have lots of employees, and so what sort of activities were involved in your influence and leadership?
Well, first, thank you for including me in this great, distinguished group of people and leaders.
You could be called a judge whisperer, I think, as far as that goes.
That's
in terms
good
of
description. I think it is an activity that is leadership, and I think one of the keys to having any success in it is knowing when to lead and when it's needed, and particularly in the role I play with the Administrative Office of the Courts and the Judicial Conference, the way our judicial branch is set up. Part of our leadership a few years back was to decentralize the leadership and move it into the circuits where it made more sense, where the circuits were more effective in the day-to-day operations of the courts. And then there are areas of where you have to exert national leadership. It's a very interesting concept within our own branch of government. It's very similar to federalism generally, where state governments and federal governments share power, and some things are done better locally and at the state and local level. The same is true within the structure of our federal judicial branch. Some things are done better locally, and some things are done better nationally coordinated. For example, cybersecurity. That's an area where we all have to be on the same page. If we didn't operate with the same standards across the board in all of our courts, any breach into any one of our court systems is a breach into the entire system. So we all have to be coordinated. And we had to exercise leadership there in cybersecurity, and there are other areas where I worked very closely with Sid in coordinating national efforts, workplace conduct being the most recent, I think. So it is an activity, and it's not a title. And if you were trying to use it as a title, I don't think you'd be very effective in day-to-day operations. And you have to exercise judgment as to when you're really required to step up and take a leading role, and when you want to delegate it to others to engage.
Well, in terms of the team effort part of it, while you have a title, you have a lot of people that are titleless, but do you expect them to be leaders, and how do you engage them in the process?
It very much is a team effort. As the Chief Justice just gave some great examples of pulling people together and collaborating. I mean, you have to have input from a number of sources to make informed decisions, to get buy-in from all of those who are affected by the decisions and the policy making. When I first started as director of the AO, I really wanted to integrate our operations with the courts and make certain that the courts recognized that we worked for them and with them. And one of the things we did was to create a director's leadership program where we brought people in from the courts to the AO for a year. I think the Ninth Circuit has had 4 participants in it over the last few years. It's been very effective for us to immerse people from the courts, bring them to the AO, and learn from them the practical day-to-day issues that they face in the court system. And vice versa, they take back to their courts hands-on experience from the administrative office in Washington. And by the way, it's good to be in a pleasant Washington today. Glad
to be out of there. Well, obviously you did certain things right, because we have the Duff 1 and the Duff 2 dynasty. So you came, you left, and we asked you to come back.
I was honored to be asked to come back, and very glad that I did. And this leadership program that we instituted has been a big success, I think, for helping integrate our work within the courts and bringing court employees into the AO, where we've learned great things from them as well.
Well, I think maybe interestingly, one of the, you know, Chief Judge, you are in a little different category from the standpoint that you're Chief Judge because you came on the court long and you were in the succession line. Perhaps the Chief Justice was selected knowing that she would be the Chief Justice. Director Duff was selected knowing that he would be assuming a leadership role. Who have been leaders that you've considered to be role models, and how have you evolved into this position?
Well, first I will say it's a little bit different because when I was confirmed by the Senate, I got a call from then Circuit Executive Greg Walters, and he said, "You're in the chief line." I said, "What does that mean?" He said, "Mathematically, you're going to be chief judge." And I said, "When's that going to happen?" He said, "19 years from now." And I said, "Why don't you call me a little bit, you know, a couple of years before the out, and maybe I'll do that." But knowing that, I think gave me the charge that I had to be a student of judicial administration. And I went to Judge Hugg, who was a great role model, and I said, "Give me the toughest job you've got that nobody else wants on a subject you need to address administratively." And we were down 10 judges, and he said, "Okay, I've got one for you. You're going to work with former Chief Judge Wallace and Judge Levy, and we need to figure out a way out of our backlog." And we undertook that, and we came up with a plan, and we solved it. But in the course of that, I learned a lot about the inner workings of the court and became interested in what other circuits were doing. And we did have the backlog solved until we got slammed with the immigration cases, and then we're back in the soup again. But over the years, I've had watching our chief judges, and I've learned from all of them, I've learned a lot. The one role model I would say for me is Chief Judge Browning. Judge Browning, who many of you know, hailed from Montana. He came from a town of Belt, about 500 people. He was first in his class, but couldn't get a job out of law school, and ended up in the antitrust division at Department of Justice. Then he went into private practice in D.C., and through his pro bono work at the Supreme Court, caught the attention of the Chief Justice, who named him as clerk of the United States Supreme Court. Then he was subsequently named to the Ninth Circuit. at a very young age. But he is, and he went to school with my father-in-law, and so we've known each other for a long time. He was actually at my law school graduation when he was first chief judge. But he was such a great leader, and what he did, and I learned from that, is he first of all identified problems, and he looked around and said, where is there a need for an improvement in judicial administration? If you look at all of the innovations that we've had in the judiciary, his fingerprints are on them, whether it's helped with the national misconduct rules, the first time that we had a system of judicial. He invented the bankruptcy appellate courts. You go on and on for what he did. But his most remarkable thing, I think, is that he led the court in a quiet way that was inclusive, and he was firm. He was a person of steel once you got beneath the surface. But he was so warm to his colleagues and so inclusive, and he listened to them. So for me, he was a great role model. I remember when I first got on the court, he was talking about one of the judges, and he said, oh, he's rambunctious and obstreperous, and I love him for it. And that was the kind of guy that Jim Browning was. He was just, he loved people, and he had a great sense of humor. And I don't remember a conversation I had with him where he didn't laugh and clap his hands and make you feel good about yourself. But he led the court effectively. He had a vision, and he brought people in.
Well, what about you, Chief Justice?
I have to say that, for me, I was surprised to be named Chief Justice. In California, it's a tap on the shoulder. When Chief Justice George announced his retirement, then it was, who knows, Arnold Schwarzenegger could appoint anyone. There was a great deal of buzz in the air. I did not see myself on that list, and I knew others who I thought ought to be on that list. And I also note that, at least in California, the Chief Justice's position seemed to be, at the time that I was coming up through the ranks in my 20 years on the trial courts and on the Court of Appeals, seemed to be shrouded in a sort of mystery. And it ran well, so I never had any reason to pierce that mystery, and I served on different committees statewide, and it ran well. And so when I received the call to interview, I also thought, oh, this is just a great interview and experience for me to tell my grandchildren. And I was surprised to be offered the position. And then once I accepted the position, I realized that there wasn't really a model for going forward in California at that time. There were so many challenges, deep in recession, a lot of unrest, not an understanding of the judiciary, courts having impossible tasks with very little financing. So I came to the position actually realizing that the best role models for me at that point were all the people that I'd had in my 30 years of work who were bad leaders, bad bosses, bad supervisors, and bad colleagues. And I thought, this is what I must strive not to be over this potpourri of bad behavior I've seen in my years as a lawyer and my years as a judge, because I know that that's toxic to getting the group to solve the problem. And then when it came to people that I could view in my life as standouts, who always made me, the minion in the corner, feel welcome, I turned to my time in the governor's office and how they would sometimes ask my opinion even though I was a nobody in the corner carrying all the briefs. And I turned to people who had been in those leadership positions in government, and then I think about being able to work for them. So I know Connie and I have many years of experience together in California, and so these names would be familiar. And that would be Appellate Presiding Justice Art Scotland, who saw the future, who encouraged me, who forced me, who signed me up for things and said, thank you for volunteering. He was just the person who shoved you out and gave you some words of advice and knew that you could work on your own. And also on that same court, Vance Ray, a judge who went to law school and graduate school and beyond and service during the time of segregation, who came out with great life lessons, who I worked for. Those were folks who gave me an idea about how to treat people, particularly in time of crisis and complaint. And then, of course, there was Chief Justice George, a man who led with elegance and a man who led with strength and humor. And I only really knew him from afar in a few very superficial interactions, but I knew that he was a deep thinker. I knew he was approachable if I ever needed to. And so it was an amalgamation of people who I thought brought to bear the skill set I would need to lead. And many of them are still in my circle of reference for when we have challenges. But I would have to say the greatest, you know, when you're learning to play golf and you've had a few lessons and then you go to the golf range and you see everyone committing every single error you're told not to. And now you really understand what the pro is saying about your backswing, about your footing, about your eye, about your posture. That's sort of what it was like for me coming up as a lawyer and a judge. I just saw so many things that I thought could have been better. And then I finally had the opportunity with great guidance to try to avoid all that and help bring together solutions with the leadership of mentors and lessons.
Director Duff, how about you? You've worked for a lot of different people and had a lot of opportunities that many people can only dream about.
Well, I have been blessed with mentors, that's for sure. And if I didn't learn anything along the way, it's my fault. But I've worked with three chief justices, admire them all. When I came out of Chief Justice Berger's chambers, I started working at Clifford and Warnke, which is a small law firm, Clark Clifford, Paul Warnke. They were great mentors to me early on in my legal career. Learned a great deal from them. And then you pick up things along the way, as the Chief Justice was describing, what you observe what works, what doesn't work, what made you feel included and empowered in some ways is a trait that you try to weave into the way you operate. I worked with Howard Baker for many years. First, I worked with him when he was on the board of the Smithsonian Institution when I was working for Chief Justice Rehnquist, and got to know him then and became managing law partner of his law firm in Washington. And he had, I thought, the best advice when he was majority leader of the Senate. He always said, listen very carefully to those who disagree with you, because they might be right. And I thought that was really good advice, and I think he was such an effective leader of the Senate, because he did listen to others who disagreed with him, and he did work across the aisle and worked on compromises that moved legislation and got the work done. I think that's a very effective trait. It's not always easy to implement, particularly when there are policy differences and philosophical, political differences you're trying to balance. And there are some things where you have to be a judge of when you can't compromise. For example, protecting our institution, the third branch. There's no room for compromise when it comes to threat to the independence of the judiciary. And so you have to stand up and hold your ground when there's legislation pending that would create an inspector general over the judicial branch. Well, there's no room for compromise on that one. You have to dig in. But the vast majority of issues you're working on and dealing with, there are good arguments on both sides of the issue, usually.
Well, someone told me once, four most important words are, you might be right, and you said those.
Right. I mean, and if you listen to others who are disagreeing with you and you pick up the things that probably are right about and include it in your decisions and incorporate those so everyone feels a part of it. I think the Chief Justice was saying exactly that at the very end of her first remarks, how she pulled together coalitions of people of varying groups. That's effective leadership. And there have been some great ones in our lifetime and some not so good ones, and you learn from both, I think.
Chief, the leadership literature often identifies the values of humility, integrity, and strong moral compass as values most important in effective leadership. Do you agree, and why should we be highlighting those? How should we, no?
I strongly disagree with Dr.
Oh, okay.
No, I think you have to approach your job with humility. When my friend, Chief Judge Schroeder, just before he took over as chief, she said, "You don't know what you don't know." And I said, "I know." And you have to have the humility to know that you don't have all the answers and you don't have all the information. So what I set out to do, and given the example of my predecessors, is to go around to the districts to really understand what the problems were, not only at the district level, the bankruptcy level, pretrial probation, so forth, and our court, and see what the needs were and identify whether it's case-related or non-case-related, and to get at try to get to the cause of the problem. So I think you approach it with humility, and also, in particular, the structure that both the Chief Justice and I have is she was picked by the governor. My ascension was mathematical, and so I had to earn respect, or try to earn respect, and I try to do that every day. But you have to be, I understand this from the beginning when I joined the court, that there were people who were senior to me that knew a lot more about court administration, about the functioning than I did, and I have to have the humility to know what you don't know and to try to learn that. On the other hand, I would say humility doesn't mean that you're going to get run over, because if you try to achieve consensus by saying, "Let's talk till we all agree," that's not going to get you anywhere. What you have to be, particularly in a time of crisis, you have to be decisive. You have to get the information you need, but you have to act. And then you have to trust others to do the right thing and to act in the right way with you. So I think it's a combination of all that. And I also think if you don't have a good moral compass, you're not going to be a successful leader. It's often more important to be honest than to be right. And I think if you bring those things to bear, you're going to have success. And I've looked at other circuits, and I've seen autocratic style of leadership, as Jim referred to, that just doesn't really get you anywhere, so particularly in the judiciary. I think effective leadership, whether it's in a hierarchical situation or in ours, you have to have a combination of all those, I think. So.
Well, Director Duff, how important do you think self-reflection is and honest feedback in leadership? And can you give us some examples of, I know you probably haven't made any mistakes, but can you give us some examples of how you may have learned from mistakes?
Well, one of the things we did when I first started at the AO in 2006, I guess it was, first of all, to answer the question directly, it's very important, I think, to have self-reflection, to listen. You learn a lot as to how to improve when you do listen to others and make observations. And when I first started in 2006, the first thing we did was send around a survey to the courts as to how we can improve, how the AO can improve. And I sort of knew what we were going to hear, because I had been counsel to the Federal Judges Association prior to that time, and I was getting an earful in those days from the Federal Judges Association about, mainly I discovered they were perceptions and misperceptions, because there was a lack of communication between the AO and the courts, or not as effective communication as there could have been. And so the survey was sent around, and sure enough, that was the feedback that we got from it, but we took that, learned from it, and have worked very hard at being the best service organization in the federal government. That's the goal we set for ourselves, so that the courts would know that we're there to serve them, and we opened up lines of communication. We put people out from the AO into the courts, because I knew once the courts were, and the very good people who work in our federal court system, I knew once they were exposed to our employees at the administrative office, it would ease tensions, and there would be solutions to issues that we were confronting. And I think it has worked better, at least I hope so. Maybe we should do another survey and find out. But there, it's very important to listen and to engage others that you're working for. But as Sid just said, it's also very important to know when you have to make decisions. And sometimes, and you just use your best judgment when those times arise.
Can you think of a time that you'll think, I won't do that again, or a mistake that something?
Jim doesn't make mistakes.
Yeah. I'll have to think about that. I think what I've learned is you have to be prepared. And when you let off, if you don't get prepared for whatever event that you're participating in, whether it be because you didn't have time or you were tired, you're not as effective. And I guess I've learned from that. I've tried not to allow myself to be unprepared for an event such as this. So I was up all night last night studying my notes.
Well, if you look at a question I asked you to learn from the mistakes, so I'll come back to you on that. Chief Justice, what role would you say emotional intelligence plays in being a good leader?
I know that emotional intelligence is somewhat of a new term, but I think what it really captures is what we've known all along, particularly as lawyers becoming judges, and that is an understanding and an empathy for the people we represent, the witnesses we put on, the people we work with. It's not only empathy, it's also about projecting ourselves. I think it's critically important. And it means really being an awareness of what's going around you, observing, watching even the faintest of actions or watching things that appear to be out of the ordinary, and even listening beyond what's being verbally stated. And I think with emotional intelligence, we end up having a healthier workplace. And it's also about letting, when you're a leader, I think, or when you convene or when you run a meeting or when it is that you face challenges, the emotional intelligence is not only you absorbing the environment and seeing around the corner and how the consequences of your decision will play out on real people, but it's also about letting the people with whom you are sitting around the table understand your emotional intelligence in the sense that has been said here by Mr. Duff and also by the chief. That is by being honest about you can constructively contradict me. You can tell me I'm wrong. I am not going to be upset by that. Unless, of course, you do it in a snotty way. But other than that, if we can set the ground rules for how we can exchange ideas about real solutions, and you know who I am, and that I'm not going to punish you, and there's not going to be revenge, and I'm not going to talk about you, and I'm going to give you a graceful way to back out of the wrong decision, and you're going to give me a graceful way to back out of my wrong decision, then emotional intelligence really moves the discussion. I think it deflates the potential drama and the consequences of the drama in a community where we all know each other, or by 3 degrees of separation, we know each other. And let's just be honest. Lawyers talk, judges talk, staff talks. And word gets around. So it's really important, I think, that we know that we're in this together, we share a common goal, we may have different ways to achieve access to justice, but we shouldn't let our emotions get in the way of it, and we should be aware of each other's calibration so that we can avoid it to get to a better solution.
You know, I would say on emotional intelligence that part of it is being able to deal with criticism in a way that doesn't engage you in the argument, and Director Duff has faced that with Congress, and the Chief Justice has faced that in many, many circumstances, particularly in kind of a showdown with the Attorney General. And you have to be able to respond to criticism in a way that's emotionally intelligent and diffuses the situation. But I think emotional intelligence in terms of the law is critically important, and let me explain why. So much of litigation, of course, is adversarial, but it's like the old Monty Python routine, the argument clinic. Some of it's reflexive. It go, I'm here for an argument. No, you're not. Yes, I am. No, I'm not. And if as judges, when we look at lawyers who are, nobody likes to see a food fight, except maybe on Animal House or something like that. But if you're seeing a food fight in litigation, that's not constructive for the litigants. It's not constructive for the parties. And what we can do as judges is to try to professionalize the relations with the attorneys and so forth. And I think attorneys have to deal with things with emotional intelligence. Judges have to deal with emotional intelligence. A lot of our, I know all of you who are trial judges, get to the point where you're so frustrated with what is going on in the courtroom that it's easy to lose your temper. But we can't, because as we're the face of justice, as Chief Justice Fairhurst said yesterday, and we have to exercise emotional intelligence, particularly in these trying times, when the judiciary is under such pressure, and we have to be the still point in the turning world. We have to be, when the other branches are dysfunctional, we have to be functional. And that, I think, is our calling, to exercise emotional intelligence on a personal level, in the courtroom, and in our nation.
Well, I guess maybe from the standpoint, emotional intelligence and understanding other people, well, they like that. But what about emotional intelligence regarding self-awareness of ourselves? And do you think that that's a distinguishing characteristic of a successful leader? Have you found that understanding your own capabilities and weaknesses have a direct effect on your ability to be an effective leader?
Well, I hope so. I mean, people have said that everybody who says, I understand my weaknesses, they by definition do not. I think there's some truth to that. But I think also you have to lead within your personality, and some people have different personalities, and I think you have to understand if you understand what you're not good at and you acknowledge that, then you surround yourself with people who are good at that and trust them. So I hope I have self-awareness, but I know that I'm not catching everything. But I rely on my family to tell me that, to hear those. Mm-hmm.
Well, Chief Justice, how important do you think is vision and inspiration in a leadership role?
Well, I think that gets back to what Michelle said about title. Because you get a title doesn't mean necessarily that you're going to be the leader. I think it's vision that helps create the leader. And to me, vision is also what you intend to do. It's that goal, that objective that probably you will never fully achieve, but all of your initiatives and projects are aimed at that vision. And vision is important because then people know what it is you stand for. It's your value. What are your values? What are your objectives? And that's what attracts people to want to work with you when they know and believe what your vision is. And I think the inspiration comes from how you engage that vision, how you bring about and make it more fulsome with the inclusion of other people. It means also, I think, the inspiration is as was discussed here, and that is if you know some weaknesses, then you invite voices that are surprised to get your invitation to come to the table to be part of the vision. And that has a ripple effect to other people who feel a little bit disenfranchised. I mean, leadership should be inclusive and accessible, and it happens with, well, what does this person stand for? What am I joining? What are we going to try to achieve together? Then how are we going to go about doing that? In what steps? And where do I fit in, and what can I bring to that? And so, yes, I think vision and inspiration matter. And for me, it's sort of like when I first became Chief Justice, they would say, well, what's your vision? And I thought, how could it be anything else but access to justice? You know, we're not a corporation. I'm not selling a widget. We are, as indicated by what the Chief Judge said, we are the judicial branch. We are justice. We are the check on the other two. So in this time frame where we have the opportunity to have title, what is the challenge and what could be our vision to address that challenge? And then what are the nuts and bolts or the objectives of achieving that vision in our tenure? And it's the articulation of that. And then, of course, how you go about telling people what that is and asking for their help, literally asking for their help in the process and respecting that help. So I think it's essential, those two, that combination towards fixing challenges that we face in the judiciary.
Well, Director Duff, I see you nodding your mm-hmm. head, but I think also, too, in terms of as a leader of an organization, I think we would all agree that you establish the organizational climate. And as a leader, how do you not only get people to join in your vision, but also inspire integrity and confidence in the people that who would be your subordinates and you want to be followers?
Well, you do try to lead by example, but I want to pick up on something the other two have said and how important it is in this time that the judicial branch be perceived and in reality as best as humans can, be nonpartisan. I think the country is hungry for that kind of leadership where issues are resolved in a civilized way. I think our branch stands for that. It's how we operate. The thing that distinguishes our branch from the other two is that we actually do make decisions. On the toughest issues of the day. And some of those get shoved into the judicial branch because the other two branches don't step up to it and get them resolved or haven't reached compromise on it. Our branch functions well, and I think the challenge for us as a branch is to maintain both the impression and the reality as best humans can of nonpartisanship, conflict resolution. So it's a lofty goal, it's an inspiration to us, should be, and I think our branch is living up to that to a very great degree, and I think public opinion polls demonstrate that that's the case. I know there are many efforts to try to politicize our branch and label it and try to funnel it into the partisan politics of the day, but to the extent we can resist that and give evidence of civilized discourse and nonpartisanship, we will be effective leaders in the country. And as I say, I think the country is hungry for that. But as to your question on and within the AO, we try to empower the individuals within the administrative office and give them some decision-making authority. Leanne Bennett, who's my deputy, she's been wonderful as a deputy. We like to be informed of all the major decisions, but we do engage others and throughout the building on and in the process. And I think you inspire integrity by the way you personally operate. And we do as a branch. I used an example this morning of the Chief Judge's breakfast where I think this is a very good example of good government and good leadership. And I think we hope it's picked up throughout not only AO but the branch as a whole. But in our budget process, I think we may be the only entity in the federal government that gives money back when we've overestimated what our budget estimate is for the year. We go to our appropriators and we say, you know, we estimated our budget was going to be X, but as a matter of fact, it's going to be Y, which is less than X because we have unexpected carry forwards or incoming fees that we didn't calculate properly. Well, the appropriators love us for that. And we've benefited greatly as a result in our budgets over the last few years because we generally get almost as much as we ask for, which is unusual in these budget cycles. But that's the kind of integrity that we try to exhibit, not only on the budget, but in all the issues we confront. And Sid said it best, you have to be honest. And people know when you're not being honest. And so that's, we try to live up to that.
Talk a little bit now, turn our attention to what we could call the paradoxes of leadership. And interestingly, the research shows that humility is not a trait that helps people make it to the top of an organization. And sometimes narcissistic individuals are frequently selected for leadership positions because of their confidence and their charisma. And, or, you know, is, so how do we, in your organizational structure, how do you ensure that you're picking the best leaders in, you know, does a rainmaker at a firm really make the best leader? You know, do we, no one really wants to work for a narcissistic person, but if people don't rise to the top, are they in a position to take over leadership? So I'm curious in each of your own organizations how you deal with the paradox of leadership in terms of who generally comes to the top, but then how you select your leaders for the qualities that we're talking are necessary for good leadership. Chief Justice?
Well, I appreciate that question because as Chief Justice of California's Judiciary, I also wear the hat as Chair of the Judicial Council, which is the, I call it the Board of Directors of the Third Branch. The Constitution gives me the authority to pick all 31 directors as well as the over 400 judicial officers and lawyers who make up our subject matter experts for our over 25 advisory committees, who then write the proposals and the rules for criminal jury instructions, civil jury instructions, civil small claims. All of the issues that arise in those disciplines then have to be addressed by this advisory committee that then makes a recommendation that trickles up to the Judicial Council and the 31 Board of Directors. So I make hundreds of appointments, and we actually have a very transparent way of ensuring that everyone has a free and fair shot at an advisory position, leadership position in the California Judiciary, and that is you submit an application, whether or not it's by yourself or you've been nominated, and we vet you based on your experience and based on your other activities. And we look for the greatest diversity, age, gender, discipline, years on the bench. Across the board, we look at cultural, we look at geographical diversity to ensure that the leadership of these committees that make these proposals are diverse, that they can sit at a table and vet all angles and aspects of the proposal. But we do this and appoint these folks through a very, I want to say, a close review. We also name the state bar court judges. We also name the state bar board of trustees. And we have procedural fairness and a procedural step-by-step so that everyone gets treated fairly, gets looked at the same, looks at the same criteria, gets vetted so that their background is looked upon. And so at least for the selections I make, I look for all that's been discussed here. I look for people who are innovative
thinkers.
So
you're kind of the gatekeeper of these leadership qualities. And so just that you're not, you know, even though people may be a really good judge, or they may have been a really good lawyer, that doesn't mean that they're going to be a leader in your organization.
Exactly. For all the reasons that said here, sometimes some of the best lawyers who become judges have a little narcissism that doesn't really play well with others. Sometimes also we need, I would say, people who have experienced and a proven track record of being able to wrestle down a challenge. People who are inclusive. So we gather that information in the branch. So remember how I said everyone talks? Everyone talks. And we end up knowing a background of folks because what we want is the best voices at the table. But that really doesn't end there because you also have public comment on all the proposals if you care to make a public comment to it. But we also realize how important it is that our leadership reflect our values. So we want to pick people who are inclusive, who are collaborative, who are engaging, who are willing to admit that they might not know that or you might be right, so that it makes a big difference about how the branch leadership as a whole is perceived.
Well, Director, do you sort of, you have make a lot of appointments. I mentioned that in your introduction of all the, of, you know, how you get to shape that. Do you sort of similarly, are you looking at these qualities when you're doing that?
Yes, I think all those qualities are very important. One that may be disqualifying in the appointments that we make, and I remember Chief Justice Rehnquist saying this, that sometimes the people who want it the most are not the people you want to pick, because they may have a different agenda and their own agenda for a particular position within our appointment structure in the branch. Although in other cases, it's a good indicator. So you have to listen and do your homework on all of these appointments. They're important. The other challenge to it is some people manage up better than they manage down, and so it's that is to say that they are liked by their superiors in the hierarchy but disliked by those who work under them, and you have to try to figure out if that's a trait that a person who is you're considering to move up into a greater leadership position, how well they work with people not only above them in the hierarchical structure, but how well they work with people below them in that structure. And so those are, it's all important. And sometimes you don't learn that until you move them and then discover, oh boy, that might have been a
Well, Chief, you have a whole audience out here of people that want to be on committees and be on things. So
we welcome that.
Yeah. What would your answer be?
I just got here by math, so whatever overconfidence I had about being second grade class president, it didn't get me very far with just math. But around the room, you look at, I mean, I am humbled by the service on our committees, and you look for great people. And for example, I'm looking here at Judges Spaeth and Owens, who put together this wonderful conference. We had a great civics meeting with Judge San Martino, the Courts and Community Committee. I mentioned some of the other committees. Judge Hamilton has done such a wonderful job with the Wellness Committee, groundbreaking work with the Memory Clinic. And the list goes on and on. And what we've tried to do with our Corrections Summit is try to solve some of the problems in the prison so they don't get in the court system. And that is, I've just been blessed with great people who wanted to do the job and did the job. And we all need collectively to work together to improve the administration of justice in the West. And it's, I've just been so honored and pleased that so many people around our circuit have contributed. And your work on the Judicial Resources Committee, thank you.
He appointed me?
Yes.
Through the Chief Justice. So, that's the... So whatever you need, let me know, and I'll try to make an argument to the Judicial Resources. That being said, there's a lot of leadership styles and strategies. And I want to talk about, you know, something with the Chief Justice that's sort of a little bit the elephant in the room, one that you and I have lived in the room with. Women are often rated lower as leaders when they adopt leadership styles that are seen as masculine or otherwise act in ways that don't conform to traditional models. And, you know, people often say that we can't be beautiful and smart at the same time, and things along those lines. I know that you have experienced comments along those lines. So have you experienced an implicit bias, or how have you compensated for it, or how have you worked through those things being bright, beautiful, and bold?
Well, thank you. Yes, of course, all of us in this room of the female persuasion have experienced in a male-dominated culture, just naturally, the practice of law, the administration of law, the judiciary, implicit bias, or sometimes called unconscious bias, which is probably really more accurate, I think, because, of course, I was a trial attorney, and I'm sure we all have stories about when we were trial attorneys, but I also think we can all agree somewhat that the kind of bias we faced back in the 80s and the 70s was unconscious. It wasn't of ill intent. It wasn't coming from a bad or negative place. I mean, face it, women were new. We were new in the litigation area. We were new in the well. It was kind of a weird, strange thing, a female prosecutor, a female defense attorney, everyone else male. So there's been a cultural turnaround where I don't think that there is as much unconscious bias, but there is. Does it exist in the judiciary of California? Oh, yes. Does it exist in our other two branches of government? Most definitely. Does it come from a bad place? I don't think so. Do I have greater expectations that it should be better considering that women have been 50% of graduating law schools for the last 5 to 10 years? Yes. Has it changed incrementally? Probably. But I think dealing with it is showing up every day, dealing with it at first with a sense of humor, at first with gentle prodding, but if it continues and continues without any improvement, then they get something else. I think it also means that we have to show up and show that leadership looks different. It sounds different. It can be addressed in a different way and be just as effective. On a computer, you have 4 ways to get to where you need to go. Same is true with leadership. There is no one way or one style. And there's no way that we can adopt someone else's. It has to be ours for it to be authentic, for us to have it and to develop it. When I was a trial attorney, I was trained by someone whose nickname in the office was Mad Dog. There was no way I could be Mad Dog. It would be ridiculous for me to be Mad Dog. So I had to be something else, whatever that was, and you have to find it. And so we continue to. When I became Chief Justice, I thought some of that was behind me, but I realized I was now entering a political realm of the legislature. Not a lot of women in California's legislature, certainly not a majority. Mostly in staff positions, having to deal one-on-one with principals, had some unpleasant moments, some publicly unpleasant moments, but moments that had to be had for us to move on and to have a serious conversation. The same is true, I think, in the executive branch. When I was appointed to the Court of Appeal, I'd been on the bench for a year, the governor wanted to meet. I showed up with my husband, he exited the door, he went right to my husband, and he said, "Congratulations, Justice Cantil Sacaue." And everyone in the room went. So there was a fair amount of just unconscious bias. I don't think there was anything nefarious about it. And so in order for us to move forward, we continue to show up, we continue to speak up, we continue to repeat ourselves, because sometimes someone else says our idea and they think it's a great idea coming from a man, but I said that 5 minutes ago. So now I know to say that. I said that 5 minutes ago. And it just puts people a little bit back, but it continues to move us forward bit by bit.
All right. All right, Director, I'm gonna take you right there. So how have you found that you've needed to adapt your leadership style based on changes in the workplace, in situations, or the personnel involved? And can you provide some examples of how?
Well, you have to read the issue and the kind of leadership that's needed, the kind of people that you're interacting with and their traits, I think, to be effective. I think some people need encouragement to be effective. When I was a CEO at the museum and the Freedom Forum, my predecessor, Charles Overby, said, "You're going to be CEO," and I view that title means chief encouragement officer, not chief executive officer, but chief encouragement officer, and you need to encourage people. And I think that's a very important element of effective management, being encouraging to those who are trying to implement policies or come up with policies. But you have to adjust that sometimes too and exercise a little more direct leadership and direction where the individuals may not take to it as well. I know sports analogies are not favored these days, and there's a bias in sports analogies, but I think at the risk
go for it.
I'll go for it. good coaches, be they male or female, realize what players they have and what motivates certain players. Some have to be given a kick to get motivated, and others have to be cajoled and encouraged. And so I think that's very much part of being an effective manager or a leader, is recognizing those differences in the people you're working with. And one style doesn't always work well. And if you're only known for one style, it's particularly ineffective, I think, because people won't learn how to play you. And so you have to, it's all about communication.
So you can treat people differently, but still treat them fairly.
Yes, you know, better said than I did.
Well,
I said that 5 minutes ago.
Oh, I think so. Yeah, you did. I know that you've all faced leadership challenges in the important positions that you hold. And Chief, since you took over as Chief Judge in the Ninth Circuit, you've faced several challenges, such as the government shutdown and responding to high-profile issues like hashtag MeToo movement. What was your approach to responding to these very high-profile, very volatile, and, you know, how did you process them, and how did you decide what was inappropriate? How did you titrate your response in terms of doing that? And what were the things that were going through your mind?
Well, first,
besides,
I wish the math had turned out differently. I think first of all, in a moment of crisis, and as you all know, we've had a number of them in the past few years. You have to take a pause and make sure you have all the information necessary to make a good decision. And you have to move decisively and fairly, but you have to move decisively, particularly now that we're in essentially a 24-hour news cycle. Actions have consequences, and if you don't respond quickly, events can quickly overtake you. On the other hand, it's important to take a pause and make sure that you're not reacting to a situation inappropriately. And by that I mean, sometimes your first impulse is not the best impulse because you don't have all the data you need. So I think you do need to take a pause, but I think doing nothing is absolutely the wrong thing. So you have to make the best judgment you can. In the government shutdown, we had a little bit of time to plan, and we complimented Jim and his staff this morning at the Chief District Judges meeting for all the data they provided, and Jim Bacher did a terrific job, and all your team did, Cheryl and the whole crew, to give us the best information. But in our circuit and in our courts, as you know, the Chief District Judges, the Chief Bankruptcy Judge, we had to make some decisions, and they were hard decisions. And I look back in the past, we were talking first about the shutdown. I said, what happened before? And what we had learned on the Court of Appeals is that during the last serious shutdown, and we did rolling furloughs then, it just didn't work. And we had, it was a terrible morale problem, and it was, we were ineffective at delivering services. So we came up with a different plan this time. And we had a lot of anxious employees who didn't know whether they're going to get a paycheck or not. And so we gathered them all together. And we got, of course, our circuit executive clerk of court. And I gave a speech. And I said, everybody's essential. We're all in this together. And we will work with you every single step of the way. And I think that reassured them. But you have to engage in that kind of leadership in those kind of situations. And if you're dealing with other crises that we've had, again, you have to talk to people, get the best information you have, but you do have to be decisive and fair.
I would say Sid Thomas is a great leader, has been a great leader of the circuit, and in crisis after crisis we've worked together on, he's just been outstanding.
Chief Justice, what would you say have been some of the maybe most controversial or groundbreaking steps that you've had to take as the Chief Justice?
Thank you, Connie. Well, when I became Chief Justice in 2011 in California, we were still in the midst and would be for the next 2 to 3 years of an economic freefall. And the scariest words I'd heard at that point when I spoke with our economic forecaster and the Department of Finance and the governor's office is that we don't know that we've hit bottom yet. And by that point, we were already in trying some of the efforts that the chief judge indicated. We were in furlough, and now we had closed courtrooms for one day out of the month, and we saw no end in sight. We saw layoffs. We saw shutting down of services, the shuttering of courthouses, the shuttering of hundreds of courtrooms. We saw an incredible backlog of civil litigation because criminal had its constitutional cutoff dates. We saw just a vision of infinite carnage to the judiciary. Many of our signature programs that had been advanced for access to justice, for example, like collaborative courts that target and recidivism that were working, were just cut back. And when I would go to the legislature, they would say, we can't spend a dollar today to save five tomorrow. And these cuts came mid-year, twice a year, so that while we started with the budget for which we could plan, the government would come in and cut us twice in that year, our plan. And so every superior court in the 58 counties in California was scrambling to meet its budget. And so every court from north to south was cutting in a different way. And residents were angry, and civil litigation and litigators were angry, and legislators were angry. And that was a time of true turmoil and a lot of finger pointing about losing $1 billion of a $3 billion budget was not through inefficiencies. These were through cuts. But there was a lot of finger pointing and a lot of rumor and a lot of accusations. So the first thing really had to be a factual accounting of how we came where we were, and then going forward from that, and looking at solutions where everyone's ox was gored, everyone's. And so there was no one happy, and the only satisfaction you had was that no one was happy. It was unprecedented cuts at the Supreme Court, the Courts of Appeal, and the trial courts, and we've never seen anything like it. And going to the legislature was hostile, because we were $22 billion in debt as a state. They didn't understand us and saw the judiciary as a department. And they compared access to justice to a family needs a wheelchair. So we were losing on the rhetoric. We were losing on the characterization. We were losing on the narrative. It came to some pretty tough conversations and some tough relationships and hard conversations that, frankly, never mended. But that's what term limits is for, because people left. The Governor Brown, was actually truly remarkable in that time, because he said no, he meant no to everyone, and that gave us all a fair amount of stability and accountability that he wasn't treating just us poorly. Thereafter, it came to issues of our spending. Audits are always of the past, so there was a lot of there was a lot of anger against the past and a lot of time spent on that narrative that didn't move us forward to solution. We ended up ending so many programs. I recently had a conversation with my administrative staff, and they feel we lost 10 years of advancement in that period of time because of the cuts and our momentum. We've built it back up. We've been able to obtain reinvestment in the branch. But that challenge alone changed a lot of personalities. And we find now, at least as the administration, as the statewide branch, it's so important to educate our new judges coming in and our new lawyers and our new staff about how our budget works, and that in a state like California, where we are 100% or almost 100% dependent on the goodwill of the state and the economic health of our state, that when there's a downturn, there's no benefit to looking to rob your partner. There's no reason for counties to point the finger at inefficiencies in another county, because that money is not going to you. It's going to revert if it's going to go anywhere. And it does no good to denigrate your own branch. So we're in the process of educating from the lessons learned from that.
Well, county. And I want to bring it to a happy note, civics education.
There you go.
Which is something that, as leaders, I know that this is something that has been incredibly important. I want to give props to our Chief Justice, who's just been named the 2019 Sandra Day O'Connor Award for Advancement of Civics by the National Center for State Courts. We're very proud of you.
Thank you.
But I know that all three of you as leaders have really incorporated civics as a part, and I'm going to start with you, Director. How is the administrative office involved in promoting civics education and outreach?
Well, we have a great program. Rebecca Fanning heads it up. A lot of information we supply to the courts and judges. We encourage judges to reach out to the communities. We believe civic education really is the best way to preserve the independence of the judiciary, and that's not anything new we dreamed up. I think Thomas Jefferson said it at the beginning of the country, that an educated citizenry is the best defense to democracy. And I think it's more and more crucial that we have it today. It's dropped out of the curriculum in many school systems, and it's vitally important to the future of our branch of government in particular, and I think our system of government as a whole. When I was at the museum and Freedom Forum, we partnered with the Annenberg Foundation and on a civic education renewal network. And there are about 30 organizations nationwide that have pooled together their efforts on civic education, and there's a website for that access by school teachers who choose to fold it into their curriculum as best they can. We're having a conference in New York on October 31st. All the circuits and all the circuit chiefs have been invited to attend and designate four people from each circuit to share information and best practices and ways in which they are engaging in civic education and outreach. So we've really embraced it as a very important part of protecting the branch, frankly.
Thank you. Well, I'm going to let the two of you sort of wrap up, and then we do have a few questions, or I will fail as moderator because I promised to answer a few. But Chief, what leadership role should judges and lawyers take in promoting and participating in civic education?
Well, we have to be leaders, and as you know from prior conferences, civics education was a priority and is a priority for Justice Kennedy, and we make it a priority. Our Courts and Community Committee has done a terrific job. The Kennedy Learning Center, which we helped found a few years ago, is doing a great job, and as you may recall, we had a civic summit conferences ago to try to coordinate our efforts circuit-wide, and we need to continue those efforts and to come up with a coordinated approach. Many districts are doing a wonderful job of civics education, whether it be through teacher institutes, whether day at the courts, but it really is critical. Because we are the misunderstood branch, which is, I suppose, is natural. But we need to educate people about separation of powers and the importance of judicial independence and how the courts work. And I would say that we were at the, as I mentioned, we were at the Civics Awards for the Civics Contest yesterday. And I have to say, it was so inspiring to see these students talk about the Constitution with such excitement. And it is year after year, but I think this was a particularly great year for that. And it was just inspiring. And when you see how interested they are when they are engaged, it really is something that tells us that we need to put as much resources as we can into this endeavor.
Chief Justice, I'll let you wrap up on that.
Well, I would say that I agree with everything that's been said about here regarding the importance of civics, and I would only add a little twist, and that is when we teach civics, my whole point is with an emphasis on the judiciary. People seem to understand or have an understanding of the legislative and the executive branch, but as just been said, the judiciary is a mystery, and that's also not only to K through 12, but it's a mystery to the press sometimes, and it's a mystery to adults. So we have collective efforts to target children, K through 12, target teachers so they may spread the word, and target adults. And we all have various programs, and we join with constitutional officers because this is a bridge that allows us to speak to someone we would never have and do not have a whole lot of in common with, to build a civics education program, like with the Secretary of State in California, or the Attorney General, who is often in our courts as an adversary. So it builds bridges, it's common ground, it inures to the protection of the judiciary, the educated citizens, the educated residents of our state and country, and we are poised to do it better than anyone else. It's just a natural part of the DNA of judges and lawyers.
10 words or less to each of you. In your humility as a leader, what do you want your legacy to be? Director Def.
He had a sweet jump shot.
Chief Justice, that senior comic, you know, class clowns, come. You brought it home for me, Chief Justice.
I'm going to invoke the sports analogy, Wayne Gretzky. A good player plays where the puck is. A great player plays where the puck is going to be.
Chief Judge.
Math helps.
So I have a few questions, and they all look, the inappropriate ones have been screened out. So it says for Judge Thomas and Chief Justice Cantil-Saakouli, how do you balance your primary responsibilities as a judge with all of your administrative responsibilities? No sleep. And do you feel that in some ways judges have been drawn too deeply into administrative details of court operations?
I think with a circuit of this size, and of course with the state of California, with the size of it, you have to, as a chief judge or chief justice, you have to be immersed in the administrative details. And what I've learned from my predecessors is you do have to balance them both, because you can get so immersed in caseload management and the problems of the districts that you sometimes ignore your own court. And that's a stress. So you do have to, and the primary focus, of course, is to make sure the Court of Appeals is working well as the circuit. And you just have to pay attention to that all the time. And it is a struggle to get the balance right, but you have to get the balance right.
Well, and you have the bad judges list. If we have something under submission over 6 months, we have to report at the court meeting. And you're practically never on there, and the one time you were on there, you said you gave yourself a stern lecture.
I did.
Right?
I got in the mirror and I gave myself a really talking to, and then I apologized.
Chief Justice?
Yes, you have to be immersed in the subatomic details, because things can blow up on you because you're not aware of that, and then it's a bigger problem to try to put the genie back in the bottle. So I think the greatest way it works, and it's 24/7, it's never far out of sight, is you have terrific teams of people. People that you've delegated, people you trust, people with whom you have a close and personal relationship, who are diligent in what they do and who are true public servants. That's the only way it works for me, is to be in contact with at least three teams of people who I marvel at every day and am grateful for what they do for justice in California.
Director Duff, since you have so many people involved in your circle, what advice do you have for those people that are looking for leadership, but they have a bad one or an embarrassing leader? How do you deal with, what would your advice be to how they deal with a bad leader when it's their boss?
That's a tough balance to strike, but when to communicate about that. But and not to take it too far down a path that we hope it wouldn't go, but there is our new initiatives on workplace conduct and the advice that and mechanisms for advice we're setting up, you're doing so within the Ninth Circuit with a leader in that regard who would be available, I think, for counseling. And we're doing the same on a national scale with the Office of Judicial Integrity. Joe Langley came to us from the 10th Circuit to set that program up, and is doing outstanding work. But working up the courage to communicate with the leader about your concerns, I think is the right way to go, depending on how bad a situation it is, of course. If it needs conflict resolution or you have a claim, that's a different kind of situation than just an uncomfortable, you know, slightly less
Well, obviously, systemically,
serious.
We always want to know about violations of law and all of those things. But I think of the three leaders that we have here, you know, maybe you all have risen to very successful places in your careers. Did you ever complain about a bad leader and survive and continue in your trajectory? Well, go ahead.
I don't, you know, as I said at the outset, I've been blessed with opportunities and worked for some very good people, and I haven't had to confront that on a personal level, I would say.
Chief Justice?
Yes, and then I asked for a transfer and got it.
Okay, and you're still here. It worked. How about you, Chief Judge?
Yes.
Yes? Is anyone on the stage? Anyway, I think we're down to 1 minute. We have time for one more question. I think I'm going to ask the Chief Justice this, because I know that we share a lot in this. Do you view yourself as a mentor? And if so, how do you view it? How do you mentor others?
I don't know that I view myself as a mentor as much as I view myself as someone always available and willing to give advice. And I wish I was the kind of mentor you are, Connie, because I know that you develop really personal relationships with your clerks as they move on, and also in your position as a trustee at UOP. My daughter's a trustee. She calls her Auntie Connie, who gives her a lot of advice that she can't get from me and wouldn't listen from me anyway. But I try to be available and accessible, because that's where we can make the personal touch.
Well, with that, I think I would like to say thank you to my amazing panel. I learned so much just listening to you, and it's been an honor in my life to have the opportunity to intersect with all of you, and I look forward to that in the future, and I'll turn it back to Michelle.
If we could please thank this panel.